Welcome from Troy, Idaho. I hope everyone's summer is going okay so far in the midst of this crazy 2020 year. It has been interesting, hasn't it? I want to give a special welcome to my church members in Endicott, and I will be with you next week, so I look forward to that. And today, we are starting part one in a new series called Blessed Are the Merciful. In this series, we're going to be looking at the question of eternal torment and what that means with this concept of a God who is merciful. You'll remember in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy." So how does this all connect together with those Bible passages that we see that speak of hell as an eternal torment that burns forever and ever? In part one today, we are going to cover the basics and look a little bit at the tension between a God who is merciful and also this idea that has occurred throughout the history of the church of a God that if you don't choose him, if you don't live up to the standards, for whatever reason, that you would actually get burned forever and ever in hell. How does this work together? Then in part two, we're going to look at the history behind these words, hell, and how it came into the Bible. And then in part three, and this is where I'd love to see your questions. If you have anything that you want to address from a biblical basis, we're going to go through all of the Bible passages that speak to hell, and then I'm going to share with you how I've come to understand these, because the Bible is our word of faith. But this is part one, Blessed Are the Merciful. So let's get into it. As we begin to try to understand the Bible, I think it would be good to remember a talk that I gave, I think about a month ago now, and it was on the hermeneutics of slavery. In that talk, it was titled, "The Bible Says It, I Believe It, That Settles It." And we looked through some situations where we have to understand you don't just interpret this with the pure literalism. I'll give you an example of that in a second. But today, right now, just briefly, I want to give four tools of ways that can help us as we try to interpret the Bible. Number one is the realization of context, time, place, and audience. What that means is it really does make a difference when we understand who the Bible writer was writing to, what was happening in that time, in that location. And that really shapes things. You'll remember in the paradox, the power paradox series that I did, we looked at some of the things that the Apostle Paul said about woman's head covering, for instance. And understanding time and context makes a huge difference that way. And that's just one example. Number two principle for interpreting the scripture is to compare scripture with scripture. That means that this Bible that we have is its own interpreter. So, if it doesn't contradict, which it doesn't, then any Bible passage that we have should be able to be harmonized with another Bible passage. That's why the Bible is the rule of faith, because it's not based off what you believe or I believe, it's based off what the Bible says. So, for example, when we read in the book of Revelation, the way to understand the book of Revelation is to go back to its key in Daniel and other texts in the Old Testament that have the same imagery and describe what is going on there. The Bible is its own interpreter. We understand the Bible by allowing the Bible to interpret itself. Number three, language. Understand word choice and the use of symbolism and metaphor. That means looking up what it said in the original, in the Greek, the Hebrew, the Aramaic. And you don't even have to be a scholar to know how to do this now, because there's all these tools that I've mentioned before, for free even, like on BibleHub.com, where you can scroll through and see what it originally said. And sometimes that really makes a difference, like we discovered with the Apostle Paul again and his word authentine, which means authority, but that's the only time that occurs in the Bible. So if that's the case, what does this particular word mean? You can zoom in on it. And then you need to understand when the Bible is talking in poetry, symbolism, or metaphor, as opposed to history. And all of those things really shape the way that we understand the Bible. It's important to read that in that context. And then number four, and perhaps most important, is the Christological method. What this basically means is everything in the Bible is interpreted through the lens of what the Bible talks about. So in John 4, verse 39, Jesus had a conversation with the religious leaders of his day, and he said, "You search the scriptures, because in them you think you have eternal life, but these are they that testify of me." Jesus was saying the whole point of the Old Testament was to understand that it points to him, and they lost that plot. Every part of the scripture is understood with its connection to Jesus. So the Old Testament matters. We can't throw that away, because that's what helps us to understand the story that comes to Jesus himself, where his cousin John sees him and says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." In the Old Testament, they did sacrifices. And then Jesus comes, and John says, "This is the Lamb to which all the other lambs pointed to. This is the real thing, Jesus." And then the other way that the Christological method helps us is like what Hebrews says. In the book of Hebrews chapter 1, we are told that in past days, God sent forth his prophets. But now in these last days, he sent forth his Son. A clearer revelation to who God is. And Jesus told his disciples when they wanted to see the Father, he says, "If you have seen me, you've seen the Father." The good news of the Bible is that Jesus is God. What that means is if we ever come across the part of the Bible that is a little bit more hard to understand, about violence, genocide, and these sorts of things, we can keep that on the table, but come back to Jesus and say, "Jesus, how can you help us understand this part? Because if you are love, and you are good, and if you never change, how does this work?" And so we allow the clear texts in the Bible to help us understand the ones that are less clear. So those four interpretive principles are helpful as we try to understand some of the complexities in the Bible. And then in addition to the Bible, there's four pillars that people have constantly spoken about. Of course, number one is Scripture, and this is the rule of faith. And that means it has to go above our own human reason, tradition, and Christian experience. But all of these things can work together, and we should listen to our own human reason when it says, "Man, how does this work? Can God be love and this makes sense at the same time? How does this play out?" Because God tells us in Isaiah chapter 1 that we can come and let us reason together. He wants us to be honest. In fact, in Matthew 7:7, he says, "Ask and you receive, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened onto you." So with this background in mind, let's take a look at one question that challenges a little bit of this idea where the Bible says it, I believe it, that settles it. That sounds great on the surface, but honestly, there's very few people that take a strict literalism to the Bible. And as we looked at in the slavery of hermeneutics, it was a strict literalism of the Bible that led Southern theologians to say that God condones and accepts slavery, because there's lots of Bible texts that on the surface seem to point to that. But as we saw in that sermon, that is not the case. Another example, and we'll read this one, and then I'll talk about it. The Bible says it, I believe it, that settles it. Well, are you sure? Let's take a look at this. Matthew 5 and verse 29. "If your right eye offends you, pluck it out and cast it out from you, for it is profitable for you that one of your members should perish and not that your whole body should be cast into hell." So I mentioned in that hermeneutics of slavery, that when I was a Bible worker, my person that trained me told me he met a lady who literally tried to pluck her eye out with a crochet hook. Now, I think the vast majority of people listening to this today would not think this is what God would literally have us to do. Okay, so if I sin, literally take your eye out. No, this is a metaphor, right? This, at least this first part of it. It's a metaphor to say, don't keep looking at the thing that causes you to stumble, because if you do that, that could lead to your own destruction. Now, in this series, Blessed Are the Merciful, we're going to look at these literal texts that speak of the second part of this text, that your whole body should be cast into hell. What does that mean? We're going to look at all of those texts, especially in part three of this series. And so if you have any questions, again, send them in. But for now, what I hope you realize is that the Bible does speak in symbolism and metaphor, and we need to carefully know when to interpret it that way. But let's continue on for now with Blessed Are the Merciful. Some of you may have seen this movie on Netflix. It's called Come Sunday, and it's a true story based on the life of Carlton Pearson. I first came across Carlton Pearson because I listen most Sundays to a podcast called This American Life by Ira Glass. And Ira Glass tells the story of Carlton Pearson, and he was forced out of his Pentecostal church because he began to question the idea of everlasting, eternal hell. And he became a universalist. Now, I differ from Carlton in that way. I'm not a universalist. I do believe in a literal hell. But what you'll see, and I recommend anybody that has not seen it, as you watch Come Sunday, is the tension that initially led to Carlton Pearson's questions. And they're questions that you start to see throughout the Bible, like in Luke 6:36. It says, "Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful." And so Carlton begins to think about this, and he's wondering, man, my friend that doesn't believe in God, my friend that struggled with whatever addiction, is God really going to burn my friend, my family member in hell forever and ever? Now I'm going to show you a clip where, as Carlton was being questioned by the hierarchy in his church, he gives this question to that hierarchy, and it's all based on the mercy of God. So I'll play it for us here now.
I want to ask you something. Is there anybody you've loved in your own life who backslid and is in hell right now?
My daddy's in hell. What about it?
And did you love him?
Of course I did. He was my daddy. But he beat my mama. He beat me. He was a fornicator.
And now God's punishing him. He's suffering in hell. He's tortured and tormented for all eternity. So let me ask you something. Would you get him out of hell if you could?
That ain't up to me.
Well, if it was, if there was a way we could negotiate with God, with Jesus in the blood, you'd get your daddy out of there quick as you could, wouldn't you?
I can't answer that.
Of course you would. Anybody would. So the question we have to ask ourselves is this. Are we more merciful than God?
Are you more merciful than God? You know, when a lot of people think about God and this idea of eternally burning hell, they think of that, and then they say, if that is who God is, then I am out. What they don't realize, and what we're going to explore a little bit today, is that judgment is actually very good news. It's different than this picture that a lot of people have of God, where you see this picture, this image of Jesus. He's knocking on a door. He says, knock, knock. Who's there? It's Jesus. Let me in. Why? I have to save you. From what? From what I'm going to do to you if you don't let me in. You see, a lot of people who have left the church have not, in my opinion, left a God of love and a God of mercy. They've left this caricature of a God who will make you pay unless you submit to him in such a way that allows him then to not burn you in hell forever and ever and ever. Now, some of you that are watching might be thinking, but who am I to question the sovereignty of God? To which I would say that is a good question. But God says, come, let us reason together. God said his definition of who he is that he is love. He said, blessed are the merciful. And just as Carlton questioned when he said, are you more merciful than God? I think a loving God, a loving parent, would welcome these questions. So what I want to do now is examine four basic views of hell that are current within the Christian church. And there's this book called Four Views on Hell. And the first view, by John Woolford, defends a traditional, literal, and eternal view of hell. And this is the common expression throughout the history of Christendom, where people believe that the Bible says just what it means in Revelation and in the words of Jesus and other places, where it says, hell, torment, burns forever and ever. Those texts are there. And so, like I said, we're going to be looking at those, especially in part three. A second view comes from Rillian Crockett, and he argues an eternal, but a more metaphorical view of hell. A third comes from Zachary Hayes, and he discusses hell as a purgatory, which is a sort of everlasting cleansing that can help get people to the next state. And then the fourth view, which is actually the Seventh-day Adventist view, although Clark Pinnock is not a Seventh-day Adventist, was not a Seventh-day Adventist, the fourth view makes a case for conditionalism. In this view, hell is a real judgment, but it doesn't torture people forever and ever. And so this is the one that I'll be exploring from a Seventh-day Adventist pastor's perspective. But, like I said, we'll also be looking at the texts and the other views as we go forward in this series. A fifth view that a lot of people bring up when the literal view is questioned is a universalistic view. In 2011, there was a pastor by the name of Rob Bell who was leading a growing megachurch in Michigan. And he wrote this explosive book called Love Wins. And when he did that, people like John Piper said, farewell, Rob Bell, because the term universalist is kind of like the term socialist today. If you want to end a debate, you call somebody a socialist or a universalist in the religious realm, and it just sort of stops the discussion. In the religious world, if you call somebody a universalist, that means for the vast majority of the church that this is somebody that doesn't actually take the Bible seriously. So Rob challenges this idea of everlasting, eternal hell. And after he wrote this book, he was no longer a pastor. But he asked some good questions. And I want to show you a short clip that started off the promo for his book, Love Wins. And again, this isn't an endorsement of his view. He says that he's not a universalist. I think he kind of leans that way. But the questions that he asks, just like the questions that Carlton Peterson asked, are good questions. So here's the clip now from Rob Bell.
Several years ago, we had an art show at our church, and people brought in all kinds of sculptures and paintings, and we put them on display, and there was this one piece that had a quote from Gandhi in it. And lots of people found this piece compelling. They'd stop and sort of stare at it and take it in and reflect on it, but not everybody found it that compelling. Somewhere in the course of the art show, somebody attached a handwritten note to the piece, and on the note, they had written, reality check, he's in hell. Gandhi's in hell? He is? And someone knows this for sure and felt the need to let the rest of us know? Will only a few select people make it to heaven? And will billions and billions of people burn forever in hell? And if that's the case, how do you become one of the few? Is it what you believe or what you say or what you do or who you know or something that happens in your heart? Or do you need to be initiated or baptized or take a class or converted or being born again? How does one become one of these few? And then there is the question behind the questions, the real question, what is God like? Because millions and millions of people were taught that the primary message, the center of the gospel,
or okay, we're going to try this clip again.
Several years ago, we had an art show at our church, and people brought in all kinds of sculptures and paintings, and we put them on display, and there was this one piece that had a quote from Gandhi in it. And lots of people found this piece compelling. They'd stop and sort of stare at it and take it in and reflect on it, but not everybody found it that compelling. Somewhere in the course of the art show, somebody attached a handwritten note to the piece, and on the note, they had written, "Reality check, he's in hell." Gandhi's in hell? He is? And someone knows this for sure and felt the need to let the rest of us know? Will only a few select people make it to heaven? And will billions and billions of people burn forever in hell? And if that's the case, how do you become one of the few? Is it what you believe or what you say or what you do or who you know or something that happens in your heart? Or do you need to be initiated or baptized or take a class or converted or being born again? How does one become one of these few? And then there is the question behind the questions, the real question, what is God like? Because millions and millions of people were taught that the primary message, the center of the gospel.
Okay, sorry about the video clip there. You can watch that by typing in Love Wins promo Rob Bell on YouTube. Now, if I was to just kind of conclude that up, what Rob's questioning is this ability of human beings to make an ultimate judgment case on people they don't know as if they were God. Can we really know that Gandhi isn't in hell? You know that for real, for certain? And the Bible actually does hint at places, like Rob's pointing out, like in Romans, where it says there is neither height nor depth, nor ages present nor ages to come, that can separate you from the love of God. God's love, according to the Bible, has no bounds. And so we have to be very careful about trying to say who is in and who is out. In fact, I would say we shouldn't try to determine that at all, except to say that is up to God. Now, to make a distinction for anybody that might be feeling a little bit uncomfortable now, but what about judgment? Isn't it clear that some people won't be there? To which I would say it does seem that it is clear. It does seem that people make the choice not to be there. And judgment actually is very good news. You know, right now, in our culture, we're seeing people that hold up signs, where there is no justice, there can be no peace. And that ultimate reality also reflects the truth of what it will be like in heaven. There would be no peace if there is people on earth that were living as if this earth was hell, and they take those same things to heaven. The molesters, the abusers, the Hitlers, the Stalins of the world that have wreaked havoc on millions of people, if all of a sudden, without accountability, we see our abuser in heaven, that's not heaven. It wouldn't be heaven for me either to know that God just lets those things slide. So God is a God of justice. And in the Bible, God says, vengeance is mine. I will repay. And that actually is tremendously good news. If a person finds the spirit of truth and love so reprehensible that they think honesty, fidelity, and truthfulness are weak and despicable, and love for others is cheap sentiment, and they reject such principles and motives, yet claim belief in God and the blood payment of Jesus, what happens to them? Blasphemy against the Holy Spirit is not merely saying that one doesn't believe in the Trinity or in the Holy Spirit. It is the functional rejection of the presence of the Holy Spirit who brings the perfection that Jesus brought into our internal worlds, hearts, and minds. The perfection of truth, honesty, integrity, love, fidelity, and so on. Rejecting this and choosing evil is the true blasphemy of the Spirit, and there is no healing for this. This is actually what Jesus spoke of when he spoke of the unpardonable sin. The only sin that is unpardonable is the sin to which the human being says again and again, rejecting the conscience of God and the Holy Spirit working on our life. Eventually, God will not force. And if we choose to follow the path of bad, of hate, and we reject our conscience that speaks to us in convictions of love and mercy and peace and all the ways that God speaks with the fruit of the Spirit, if we reject that again and again and again and again, eventually God says, okay, and he will leave us to our choice. And that's why it's the unpardonable sin, is because we choose to reject God. And if we do that, heaven would not be heaven for us, for God to force us there. And it also wouldn't be heaven for the people that have been victimized by our abuses. For example, if Hitler ended up in heaven without any change, without any confession, and all of the Jews that were victims of the Holocaust see him there, and he's just fine, smiling. No, saying, hey, you know what? I am sorry for the hell that I put you through on earth. No accountability. All of a sudden, for the people that are there, they would look to God and they would say, how is this right? And they would have a fair question to ask. So in these five views on hell that we discussed, number one is this idea that hell burns forever and ever. And let's say we put Hitler there in this idea of an eternally burning hell. Right off the bat, that sounds like this could be a good thing. And I could even imagine, like, somebody as bad as Hitler and what he's done, I could imagine that I could say, okay, let's watch him burn. But man, honestly speaking, I think after 20 minutes of that, it would start to get pretty revolting. Because there's actually this miracle taking place where instead of dying, he lives on, but in the agony of hell and torture. Well then, what about a year? Maybe 10 years? That's a long time. But we're talking about eternity. And then that's Hitler. But what about somebody that just rejected God? Same thing? It starts to become very uncomfortable to me. Now, if it's biblical, that's one thing. And like I said, we'll get into that in the third part of the series. Now, in the second view of hell, this metaphorical aspect, it doesn't really make sense to me because you start to dismiss the whole Bible in that way. Although I recognize that you have to understand where symbolism takes place and where literalism takes place, but I'm not really comfortable with just saying it's all metaphorical because it just sort of dismisses the whole thing in a nonsensical way to me. A third view is a sort of purgatory. Now, in this view, you could imagine a scenario where God is trying to make somebody come to the place where they submit. But in this view, it almost, because they're being tortured, You know, even in our society, you could get somebody to make a confession because they're tortured. But I don't really see God working that way either. It comes across as the knock-knock version of Jesus. Knock-knock, who's there? Jesus, why? Why are you here? To let me in. And if you don't let me in, then I'll burn you forever and ever. I'll keep you burning you until you submit. I just have a little bit of an issue with that. And then in the fourth view, the view that Seventh-day Adventists have is the conditionalist view, which means that somebody like Hitler ultimately is judged because he can't come to the heaven that God wanted him to come to, that he wants everybody to be part of, but he rejected that, and so God says, fine. And the result is eternal, everlasting destruction, but not torture. Now, I'll hint at a text here, and we'll give more in the coming weeks, but what does the most famous text in all the Bible say for most people? It's John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son that whoever believed in him would not what? Not perish, but have everlasting life. If you have everlasting life, the opposite of that is death. Not everlasting life while being tormented in hell. That's just a little bit of a hint of where we'll be headed coming in the coming weeks. And then the fifth view that we already looked at a little bit is this universalistic perspective, universalism. And in this view, some people would say that in the ceaseless ages of eternity, God could convince everybody that he was good. And in some ways, I like to believe this idea, but I just don't see enough biblical evidence for it. But we'll discuss this more in a little bit. But first, let's take a look at some of what the church fathers throughout the ages have said in regards to a literal burning hell. This is Thomas Aquinas. And some of these are paraphrases, and some of them are direct quotes. Aquinas says, that the saints may enjoy their beatitude and the grace of God more richly, a perfect sight of the punishment of the damned is granted them. Any trace of pity would darken the joys of heaven. What is Thomas saying? He's saying that heaven is even better because we get to see the tyrants of the past getting tortured forever and ever. And that actually, as we're in heaven and enjoying the goodness of God, we can look at that and say, ah, man, I am thankful that I am here, and those people deserve that. It actually makes our joy more complete, according to Thomas. What about Tertullian? He echoes this in a way, and he says, what sight gives me joy, which rouses me to exaltation? And he answers it, the eternal damnation of the tyrants, of the monarchs, of the people who are suffering in hell. That gives him joy. That gives him bliss. What about Martin Luther? He says, the saved will rejoice to see even their former loved ones roasting in hell. So now, it's not just the tyrants. It's not just the despicable monarchs that made living on earth hard. This is even former loved ones that didn't choose right or do right or whatever it is that made it so somebody that said the just shall live by faith was able to get into heaven. These are former loved ones, and he says, yep, we'll actually rejoice to see them in hell. Then is where it gets really interesting with Blaise Pascal and John Calvin. Blaise Pascal, of course, the famous mathematician, and John Calvin, the person who the idea of predestination is largely derived from. So Blaise Pascal says, the damnation of unbaptized babies is just part of the great mystery of the cosmos, and we just can't understand it, and we shouldn't try. So he says, like, this isn't just for the Hitlers of the world. It's just not for the tyrants of the past. Yeah, even unbaptized babies are going to be burning forever and ever and ever. John Calvin goes further, and he actually said that hell is full, chock full, of unbaptized babies. Is this who God is? Blessed are the merciful, for they shall inherit the kingdom of heaven. Well, what if I didn't baptize my baby? Blaise Pascal said, it's going to be tortured in hell. And Calvin says it's actually chocked full of this sort of scenario. Now let's give a different view. And in the Adventist Church, one of our founders is a person named Ellen White. And just so everybody's aware of that may not be as familiar, the Adventist Church goes by the Bible and the Bible alone. In fact, we don't even require anybody to come into the church and believe the writings of Ellen White, but we think that they can be beneficial. In her own experience, she went through a period of time, especially in her teenage years, of believing in eternal torment. I'm going to share some of the things that she said. She says, I believed in an eternally burning hell, and as I thought of the wretched state of the sinner before God, I was in deep despair. I feared that I should be lost and that I should live through eternity suffering a living death. She adds, night after night, while my twin sister was sleeping, I would arise and bow by the bedside before the Lord and plead with him for mercy. The only words that I had any confidence to utter were, Lord, have mercy. Such complete hopelessness would seize me that I would fall on my face with an agony of feeling that cannot be described. Based on her own struggles as both a youth and an adult, she spoke emphatically about the negative impact of traditional beliefs concerning hell, saying, it is beyond the power of the human mind to estimate the evil which has been wrought by the heresy of eternal torment. The appalling views of God which have spread over the world from the teachings of the pulpit have made thousands, yes, millions of skeptics and infidels. In fact, she says, hell, as it's generally depicted, is more than the human psyche can contend with. Many have been driven to insanity by this harrowing thought. In the coming weeks, I'll be sharing some views where atheists actually kind of bring out the same point, where they have debates with Christians or where they challenge Christians to say, hey, if you really believe this, like the burden is on you to tell every single person in the world because this is horrible stuff. But they say, like, I don't believe it because if that's who God is, I don't want to be with him in heaven. Now, all that said, if that is who God is and the Bible says that, we need to be clear. So that's what we're going to be doing in this series. But one more quote from Ellen White here, and she says this, it is the glory of God to be merciful, full of forbearance, kindness, goodness, and truth. Does that resonate with who you see God being? Because it does for me. But the justice shown in punishing the sinner is as verily the glory of the Lord as is the manifestation of his mercy. Justice and mercy go together. And that is why in the Bible, the very throne of God is described as his mercy seat. That's why he says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall inherit the kingdom of heaven. He desires that everybody comes to repentance. But not everybody does. But he's not looking to make us pay and to torture us forever and ever. There's an interesting example of this that I came across this week again in the book by Mark Twain called The Adventures of Huckleberry Finn. Fascinating story. And it's interesting that even today, this book is on many of our school's banned reading list. But what Mark Twain does in this story, especially in the context of the time that he was writing, is fascinating. So, Huckleberry Finn has a friend named Jim. Jim is an escaped slave, and Huck is protecting him. He's hiding him. But then he comes across a poster with a $200 reward to return Jim to his slave owner. And Huck has been taught in Sunday school that people that do the kind of thing that he's doing burn in hell. The kind of thing being protect another man's property, that being a slave. And as you recall in that sermon that I gave, The Hermeneutics of Slavery, Southern theologians again and again and again said that slavery is allowed And it was only because of the liberals and the communists that the influence was being changed. So Huck, according to Twain, reads this and he thinks, I have to return Jim to his owner or else I will burn in hell forever. So he writes a letter and he addresses it to the slave owner, Margaret, and he's ready to sign it and send it, but then he gets to thinking, man, I might be the only Jim friend, the only friend that Jim has. Jim, trust me. I can't do this to Jim. So then Huck makes the decision, all right then, I'll burn in hell. George MacDonald, famous theologian that actually influenced many people in the church, including C.S. Lewis, made the point, like Huck, that it's better to go to hell to be with your brother than to leave him there to be in heaven. And not just better, but better and more Christian. The point of heaven is that we've all been made so loving and so Christ-like, so empathetic, that we do no harm to one another. If that were the case, what we all would do is leave that place and go be with those who are suffering in hell. And this argument is basically that there would be no heaven if all we knew that our brothers and sisters were, if we all knew that our brothers and sisters were being tortured in hell. This is what we see through Jesus, right? So Jesus leaves heaven and he comes to this earth. He considers it not robbery to become a human and then to be tortured and put to death on a cross. Then he says to us, take up your cross and follow me. So imagine if we get to heaven and Martin Luther's there and John Calvin's there and we're watching babies burn. Not just Hitler, babies burn. And Tertullian says, aren't you happy? Isn't this increasing your joy? If you are a Christian and you've learned from Jesus, blessed are the merciful. I think you would pull your hair out because you're thinking, this is not bringing me joy. This is not good. Jesus, what should we do? You know what Moses said? Moses confronted God after the children of Israel had that idolatry situation where they made the golden calf and God was telling them, "This, what is this?" And Moses says to God, and he says, blot my name out of your book. Took up his cross. And God said, no, I'm not going to do that. Each person is accountable to their own sin. But what Moses did there as an intercession was what Jesus does for us. And like MacDonald says, that actually is the more Christian and better way. If there was an eternally burning hell, this wouldn't be heaven. And that's the point that MacDonald is making. Karl Barth puts it like this, this much is certain, that we have no theological right to set any sort of limits to the loving kindness of God, which has appeared in Jesus Christ. Our theological duty is to see and understand it as being still greater than we have seen before. Who can comprehend the love of God, Karl Barth says. And then he makes the point, anyone who doesn't believe in universalism is an ox, but anyone who teaches it is an ass, a donkey. He's holding it in tension, and he's basically saying, we should desire that every single person should be saved. We should want that from God, and God's love is past our understanding. But to immediately go all the way and say, it's all good, Hitler, anybody, come on in, that doesn't quite work either. There is judgment, and judgment is good news because it means that the rape, the stealing, the murder, the abuse, God says, enough. He wants heaven to be a place of peace, which means that there also has to be justice, but not torture. So this has been part one of Blessed Are the Merciful, Eternal Torment and a Merciful God. I'll be curious to get some of your questions, if you have them, as far as what about this Bible verse and that Bible verse? And we're going to look at that again in part three. But what we're going to do next week is look at some of the Greek origins that came in and started making our current day understanding of hell different than what it was in a Judeo-Christian worldview initially. The other thing we're going to do is look at this concept of the soul, and that very much connects with this idea of eternally burning hell. So I recommend that book, The Four Views on Hell. I also recommend the movie Comes Sunday that shows the story of Carlton Peterson. Again, I don't believe like he does in universalism, but the questions he asks are good. And then for a view that actually coincides with the one that I have, I recommend a movie called Hell and Mr. Fudge. And you can watch that on Amazon or YouTube. I think it's can be rented for $2.99. And he also paid the price of questioning the idea of everlasting hell. And he was forced out of the church that he loved, but he was a deep theological student and he comes up with his reasons. So look forward to continuing the study with you and look forward to your questions. Let's end with prayer and then you can be on your way. Dear Father in heaven, 1 John 4:18 says, there is no fear in love, because perfect love casts out all fear. You tell us that you are, by definition, love. 1 Corinthians 13 says, love is patient, love is kind, love keeps no record of wrongs, love is not easily angered, love never fails. But yet we live in a world that fails all the time. There's sickness, there's disease, there's chaos. And we need good news. We need you to come again. We need you to make these things right. So help us to trust you, that you are a God of justice and mercy, and you hold these things in perfect tension. So we claim the promise in Micah 6, verse 8. You've shown us, O man, what is good. What does the Lord require of us? To seek justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. We pray these things, Jesus, in your name. Amen. And as we continue to explore this question, are we more merciful than God? I look forward to showing you this beautiful picture that I've come to understand, that God is merciful and just, and he's better than we have even imagined. And that picture is actually clear in the Bible itself. So send in your questions and continue to watch this series as we explore it together. Grace and peace.